Okay, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Yuta Saito from 2015, and welcome to Alumni Day 2018. First things first, we're filming the entire event, and we're live streaming the event onto YouTube now, so that people abroad can also take a look at what we're doing today. Okay, so as I've said, my name is Yuta Saito. I'm the head of the organization committee of Alumni Day 2018. I'm going to be facilitating the event today with our own Professor Shingo Oue.
Okay, for those of you who forget me, I'm Shingo. I'm Shingo Oue, data scientist, and also a faculty in charge of the alumni relations. So if you want to donate some money to iShares, please let me know first. Thank you.
Okay, so let me just start off with the time schedule of the day. This year, we've made the event considerably shorter from the previous years. The event itself is going to last 2 hours, and the reception begins from 4:30, so that you guys can go drinking a lot earlier than previous years. And from two to four, we're going to have updates from the Alumni Association, as well as the updates from school from our own Kazuichijo sensei. And then we're going to have a speech from the 10-year anniversary class, which is the class of 2008, sitting right around there. And then we're going to have a panel discussion from the distinguished alumni panel panelists. And after the coffee break, we're going to have an award for significant contributions to the alumni network. And then after that, there's going to be a speech from Hiro Takeuchi sensei about his recent research activities. And then off you go to the reception. So that's the entire flow. So let me just update you guys on the state of the Alumni Association really quickly. So there's 858 members now, considerable amount of number. Most of those residing in Japan, but there's a lot residing in China and others, North America, Europe, Africa, Middle East. So we still have a pretty diverse population. And the alumni board, we started out with 5 members in 2017, but we have a lot more people contributing to our work now. More people are always welcome. So we have some retiring alumni board committee chairs. Ian Fontaine from 2013, who was heading finance, and Mandy Zhang, who was heading overseas chapters, as well as myself, who was leading the events, are retiring this year. So there's going to be a big change. And we always welcome people who want to take a lead in alumni association activities. So let us know if you're interested. Lavi Penaverdi from Philippines said she wanted to join the alumni board. Some of you may know her from the Philippines chapters. She was leading the Philippines chapters for a long time, so she's going to be in the board. Right. So that's it from my side. Let me give you Dean Kazuichijo to update us on the state of the ICS school.
So thank you very much. Welcome back to Chiyoda Hitotsubashi. Okay. So I'm very happy to see very familiar faces. You know, you look great. Okay. So let me give you the updates of the Hitotsubashi the ICS. Especially the title for my this opening remarks is new ICS. Because we have so many new things, especially starting from the program. Okay. So the from September last year, we have 3 degree programs officially: MBA, EMBA, and DBA. So 3 degree global programs, and also we run the non-degree programs, executive education, and we are quite strong also in this kind of non-degree activity. And so the new ICS brand, kind of the identity, premium, and the boutique, and bespoke. Okay, we should aim for the high quality education and research, so therefore we should premium. And we are small, boutique. And we want to maintain the very close interaction between faculty, staff, and the students, and also the bespoke, customized for your needs. So these are kind of the common things, the around MBA, EMBA, and DBA. Okay. This is kind of new MBA. So let me introduce the MBA and the EMBA in more depth. So the MBA, DBA, EMBA, and the MBA. So starting from MBA. So this is the kind of profile for the class of 2017. Okay. Very high score, GMAT. And the GMAT's highest, 760. You feel very relieved. Anyway, so we are very happy, you know, having those great students, okay, class of 2017. So they please enjoy talk with them during the reception. And then from this year, we have new EMBA, okay? So this is a profile for our new EMBA. So we start small. We have 15 students. So out of 15, we have 9 EMBAs. Could you stand up? So these are the very fast EMBA. So welcome, thank you. Welcome to the alumni day, thank you. Also please enjoy the talks or with them during the reception. So we started the EMBA last September. This is kind of some pictures for the MBA, EMBA kickoff on September 3rd. And we started a little bit earlier than the MBA program. So this is kind of a snapshot for the EMBA. And if you are interested in coming back to ICS again, please come to the EMBA. And but you know, please pay, the tuition is a little higher. Actually, this is not the tuition, service fee. We don't get any profit. Because this is kind of a very expensive program. So after EMBA, they just came back from the global EMBA, Global Network Week. Okay. So then now we participated in the EMBA Global Network Week. So they went to the many countries and then they came back to Japan. And also in April, they went to the Silicon Valley to do the immersion session in Silicon Valley. And also in February, they went to the Bangalore in India. So it's a very creative program. And the program director for EMBA is Ito-san, Tom Ito. And also Yoshi is also very working closely with Tom Ito. Okay. This is truly exciting. If you want to come back to Ito-san, please come back. Please come to the EMBA. So next topic is DX. Digital transformation, okay? Disrupt or disruptive. So we want to transform ICS education and using digital technologies. Actually, we started DX last year. We began to use Zoom for myself, for sessions, for the project management, for the sessions with guest speakers, and which is quite effective. But we want to move ahead. So therefore, last year, we built new digital studio, on the sixth floor. So it's a new the studio, uses Yoshi, okay? You know, then the kind of state-of-the-art kind of the system for the digital education. But then with that, we can create this kind of content. So the video production system, Chroma Key, okay? We do the presentation, the sessions, just as if we were in New York, okay? So we can create this kind of content using the state of the program. So we are going to develop the web-based contents, and so the digital transformation is a kind of mass item, the strategic agenda for the Hitotsubashi ICS. And also along with the DX, we revised the website, which is quite cool. Okay. So you see the more digital elements coming from ICS, for research, for education, yeah, which is fun. Now finally, I have to say this, HUB, Hitotsubashi University Business School. Yeah. This is kind of big change. We started April this year. And actually, this is the business education at Hitotsubashi University, the until March this year. So they, we had the two graduate schools, graduate school of the commerce and management in Kunitachi, Shoga Kenkyuka in Japanese, and we have ICS. And then these two graduate schools got integrated in April this year to form new Hitotsubashi University Business School. They comprise of the two schools. Two schools of the business administration in Kunitachi, and also the school of the international corporate strategy. It's us. Okay. And so the, now the Hitotsubashi University Business School, two schools. And but you know, the, we the kind of the it's kind of the representative school for the global education, global MBA, global executive education. So that means our mission became we got a bigger mission. Okay, we should take the lead in innovation and in globalization at the entire Hitotsubashi University. So therefore, we are this kind of very important mission, and so that we want to go ahead in your journey for the transformation, innovation, and globalization. Although we became a school, we can maintain our independence, autonomy, in terms of the strategy, finance, research, education, recruitment, everything. So therefore, actually, we have now three deans. Okay? Dean for the School of the Business Administration, and School for the International Corporate Strategy, it's me, and the Dean for the Hitotsubashi University Business School, Hitotsubashi University Business School. But you know, that dean is kind of nominal. just you know, that dean is you know, working on the coordination between these two schools. So therefore, no change. So we can enjoy our freedom. And so therefore, RCS never changed. So therefore, Hitotsubashi, yes, we maintain this kind of the brand name. Also, we maintain our logo, okay? No change. And so, but you know, this is kind of the mission for Hitotsubashi Hub, strategic the targets. Hub, they want to be number one here in Japan. You know, they're kicking out the Waseda Business School and the Keio Business School, they'll be out. and also, we should take the lead in the global MBA, EMBA, and DBA. So we want to get ranked among the FT100 EMBA and EMBA, which will be happening. Okay, and for the purpose, we are doing the kind of AACSB accreditation, which is going well, and probably we can get the accreditation within maybe early 2019 or maybe mid 2019. So then this day will be coming soon. Okay. We should be recognized as a global MBA and the EMBA and DBA, and so we want to move ahead in our journey, and then to create the bright new future. And for that purpose, the collaboration among the alumni, the new current students, and also the staff, faculty, which is crucial. So therefore, we want to collaborate with you. So that therefore, let's create the ICS, new ICS together. Okay, thank you very much.
All right, thank you, Kaz-sensei. You're right on time, 15 minutes. Okay, so we have next, we have a speech about work and life from the representative class of 2008, Makoto Sakaue-san. Please welcome me and Jerry. はい。はい。 I'm Makoto Sakaue. On behalf of the 2008 class of 8, I'm very glad to happy to deliver make speech of celebration speech of 10th anniversary. Today I want to briefly explain myself and then, okay. Firstly, I will brief my explain. I was a 2-year program student and self-sponsored student. After the graduation from 2014, I worked in Dubai as a manager of Itochu Corporation of Corporate Planning of Middle East.
Then from last year, I joined the Lixil Corporation. Currently, I'm a manager, and I'm engaging in post-merger integration of intellectual property of Japanese technology, Inax, German technology of Glowe, and Asia and US technology of American standards. So now currently, I'm integrating in four regions' technologies. So that's challenging. Sorry. So the next, I will explain to, from now, I will want to explain to the, our class. Our class is at a total of 54 students. The male is 31, female is 23. The number one majority is Japanese, 12. And the second one is at Korea, eight classmates. This picture is at when Michael Porter, as you know, taught competitive advantage class of the Hiro Take Sensei's class. Okay. Our class journey starts by the Takao's team building class. This is a good memory. Before Takao's team exercise class, we were giving one paper of classmate profile pictures. The 54 classmates profile pictures there. Today, among 54 classmates students, happily 12 classmates attend this celebration. Our classmates stand up. Our classmates stand up. Among 20 classmates, 11 classmates came from overseas. Class rep Yasushi-san came from London. The other came from Korea, Malaysia, Myanmar, Philippines. Yes. Okay, next. Seattle, sorry. Seattle. Sorry, I forgot to. Looking back to the time background of the class of 2008, class of 2008 is at the Dean's Takeuchi's last support for a full time of first year curriculum. Kazu sensei transferred to from Hitotsubashi Social Science, Shakaigakubu to ICS in 2007, and Kazu sensei started to teach knowledge management class in 2008. With Nonaka sensei. Today, Kinni Koga sensei coming. Actually, Koga sensei is the first to teach accounting to class of 2008. The most shocking event was that before that Takao's team building exercise, Lehman shock happened. And that's why that finding employment was extremely very difficult. Probably a current IC student cannot imagine how tough it is. Actually, 1 year program student chose Ryunen. Ryunen means that stay in school for one more year. By failure of obtaining seminar credit. Because this means that staying in school is better to look for a job than finding a job after graduation. So that's why very difficult situation. For that career placement. And our class's most characteristic is that very strong network and friendship. Why we could create such kind of strong network and friendship is that almost every Friday, due to strong leadership, so that rep Masato, our class holds TGIF. That's why we could create a great creating strong network and friendship. I want to say that drinking party is very good for creating bar network. Looking back to that our class activities, the most surprising event for me is that our class organized China study tour by our class by ourselves. At that time of class, at that time of 2008-2009, ICS doesn't have no relationship with Chinese university. But due to strong leadership of Masato and by help of that ICS faculty and by cooperation of that company-sponsored classmates, we could successfully appointment and visit to 10 companies, 2 governmental organizations, and 2 MBA schools located in Beijing, Tianjin, and Shanghai. I was so surprised that we could buy by ourselves. The most surprising that the visited company, for example, Stick and Baidu and Uniqlo. At that time, Uniqlo was a very small business, but currently in China, very big business. So that's why I'm surprised to see the list of the company. And networking party with Tsinghua University and Beijing University. That was very surprising. The next, and after the graduation life, I want to say, that after the graduation, our strong network and friendship continues because we could create domikai during academic life. When classmates living overseas coming to Tokyo, we usually hold nomikai. Also, we have a strong network contains all over the world. In Korea, Malaysia, Philippines, Dubai, Myanmar, Indonesia, Thailand, Singapore. I forget to put a picture of the Taiwan. And when I lived in Dubai, no classmate was there. But during my stay in Dubai, 2 classmates moved to Dubai for work. So I could meet Dubai, my classmate. That time I realized that my classmate friendship and network is strong. This is last year, I attended a small study tour, Gashiku in Israel. The 2 Japanese and 1 Indian, 1 US guy and 1 Brazilian went to Gashiku in Israel. We went to Mikimoto, a luxury hygiene company, and we learned that the essence of entrepreneurship, how Kokichi Mikimoto created the culture of the past and created a big famous jewelry company. And we went to Isejingu, and we went to Shima Kanko Hotel to learn how world of politics takes place. So this is also a good memory. Finally, I want to go back to that ICS mission and vision. ICS mission is that Mission mentioned that achieving the best of the 2 worlds by acting as a bridge linking Japan to Asia and the globe. And the vision said that developing global-minded leaders who are expert on Japan, immersed in Asia, and prepared to make significant and positive impact. And looking to my classmate, I think that ICS help to develop the global-minded leaders for a class of 2008. One example is that of career after my MBA or our class said, I told that our class is 12 Japanese classmates. Among 12 Japanese classmates, 5 of Japanese classmates have obtained opportunity to work overseas after the ICS, such kind of Malaysia, Singapore, London, Dubai. And actually, 2 classmates were seconded to Japan from overseas companies, from Brazil and US. US is a Boeing. So, and for example, another one is that a Korean guy currently works in Japanese Sogo Shosha and now works in Indonesia. So now what I want to say that we can bridge that acting the best of the world by bridging the business of linking Japan and Asia and all over the world. So ICS played a big role for such kind of global-minded leaders for our class. Finally, I want to say thank you, but Takeuchi-sensei have not yet come, but I want to say thank you, Takeuchi-sensei. Takeuchi-sensei made a good home party and BBQ party at Takeuchi-sensei's house. And Takeru-sensei has actively supported our academic life. And so I'm very, our class is very thankful, want to say thank you to Takeru-sensei, and it's a very good memory for us after the graduation. Actually, I remember Takeru-sensei's very famous words. His words is that, I like his words is that, no guts, no glory. Just before I left Dubai, I made the skydiving over the palm. Wow. After making guts, I realized I could obtain many things. So we should keep in mind Take-sensei's words, no guts, no glory. Finally, I want to say thank you to Kazu-sensei. This time our 11 students came living overseas could come to this event. This is because of strong support of Kazu-sensei and Sen-san. Our class would like to say thank you very much to Kazu-sensei. Actually, this picture is at 2009 with Kazu-sensei with drinking party. thank you very much.
Thank you, Makoto-san. You actually finished earlier. That's the best thing. As an organizer, the time is the biggest part I care about. So that's a really good thing. Okay. So right. Next up, we have a panel session, Life and Career After MBA, with the panelists Niti Mehara from class of 2013 and Ace Watanabe from class of 2010. So could you, we'll just prepare the chairs, so I would appreciate it if you can wait for just a minute. And as a facilitator, we actually have a current student, Ken Lee, from 2016. He's going to facilitate the event, so I'm going to give you
the... Testing. Thank you, Yuta, for the introduction. My name is Ken. I'm from class of 2016, expecting graduation this August. And today we're very lucky. It is my pleasure to introduce the next part of our program, which gives us an opportunity to hear more stories about our alumni. And I think you'll agree with me that ICS strength lies in its diversity. And so we're very lucky to have two panelists today, one who's Japanese and one who's non-Japanese. If you could please join me in welcoming Ace. And Nitin. And I'll give them a short moment to briefly introduce so we know who we're talking to today. So first off will be Ace.
Can I sit down?
Oh, of course,
okay.
Please.
Okay, so thank you, Ken. I'm really honored to be here. My name is Ace. I'm class of 2008, so same class as Makoto. Where is Makoto? Okay. Yeah. So I'm really honored to be here to be part of this great alumni event and also sharing with you some of my thoughts about ICS and MBA. Just going back to Makoto's presentation, you know, he showed a lot of pictures of nomikai at izakaya. So 50% of our time was like drinking probably. But again, I'm showing nomikai pictures here. So anyway, sharing a little bit about my career and background, I first started my career at Microsoft Japan. So I spent 6 years there, basically, you know, high-tech company, right? And I wanted to change my career from high-tech to something more like business-oriented. So I decided to leave the company and do a full-time at ICS. Then I joined a startup and joined a company called Catalina Marketing. So, you know, big data is a buzzword now, but that was a little early time. Then I joined a company called Teradata, another big data company. And recent years, obviously, I'm really into hamburgers, right? Two hamburgers brands, McDonald's, and currently I'm at Burger King. So helping the non-digital company to transform their business with digital. That's what I'm doing.
All right, and next we'll introduce Nitin.
Hi, thanks for this opportunity. I'm really honored to be here. And thanks to AS for letting me use his template. Actually, it's his template. I did mention the source, AS, there. Please do mention the source every time. That's very important. my name is Nitin. I'm from class of 2013. I'm from India. However, majority of my career, I've been working in Japan since 2005. I've started with HCL. It's a technology, a leading technology company in India. I was working there as project manager and quality. I thought of moving to business development. So I moved to Tata Consulting Services in Japan and supported them starting their mobility and big data business. While working there, I realized I need to more business fundamentals in order to switch from IT to business. So I chose and decided to go for an MBA and move to ICS. During ICS, I got interested, thanks to Yoshi. I was in his Zemi, interested in marketing and strategy. And post MBA, I joined Philip Morris Japan, which is a non-CSV company though, but happened to be. I was there and I was working in digital marketing and digital analytics, working for brands like Marlboro and IQOS. And recently I moved to a company called Mizumi. They do make products for factory automation. I'm working for corporate strategy, focusing on business expansion and M&A. Thanks.
Do I have a microphone? Or?
Oh, yes, of course.
Sorry about that. Actually, it's okay. I think, can people hear me in the back? Oh, okay. So thank you to both panelists for the introduction. So let's start this panel discussion here. The first question we have is, what were your thoughts on the MBA sometime shortly after you graduated? And perhaps given a couple years later with your diverse experience, has the thought of the MBA changed? And we'll start off with Ace.
Okay, so actually I didn't really spend time on that last 8 years, so since after my graduation, but this was a great opportunity to kind of step back a little bit and think about that in my career. So I would say open-mindedness is the one keyword. And so open-mindedness by being exposed to different ways of thinking. So different people from different countries, different people from different industries. So being from a high-tech industry, that was quite impressive to have those kind of thinking. And especially since now I'm doing digital in a non-digital company, you really need to have that kind of open-mindedness to understand what people are doing there. But you still need to bring in a new digital, you know, ways of thinking. So open-mindedness is my answer.
Thank you very much. And we'll have Nitin answer the same question.
Just after graduation, you know, the first thing was a big financial relief. I was a self-sponsored student and my savings were dried up, so it was a big relief to see a first paycheck in my account. For a few months, I was very happy. and most important was that, you know, MBA had changed my outlook. I had an informed perspective towards everyday issues at work or business problems which we see normally in our work, like it can be consumer behavior, consumer segmentation, product portfolio strategy, and etc. I was having, in business, I was getting much more critical towards all those issues. What was the second part? Sorry.
Oh, and has the thought changed over time?
Yeah. Yes, the thought did change over time. After working for like 3-4 years, I realized it's just the tip of the iceberg. The frameworks and concepts which we have learned at ICS, we need to go back to them and explore them in much more depth and understand them in the context of our business, which is totally different from classroom.
Thank you very much for your answers there. The next question we wanted to ask was, what was the positive impact your MBA had on your career? And on the other side of the coin, were there any negative impact on your career?
Should I go for
it? Yes, please.
Okay. Just to remind, like I was mentioning in my introduction, one of the reasons for doing an MBA was to switch from IT to business. And with an MBA, it had equipped me with all the business fundamentals you need to make that switch. That switch was much more easier for me. Without that, it would have been very difficult to do a marketing for a brand like Marlboro or work for, you know, other big brands and do strategy, which I'm doing currently. So that was a big positive impact on me. Regarding negative, I'm not sure it's negative. As I mentioned earlier, it's just the tip of the iceberg. So it's just a start. You have to go back to the concepts and frameworks and everything what you have learned again and again and keep adding the new ones, which you do by extensive reading. Recently, just to give you a recent example, I was looking in, we were looking into the expansion on, in one of the geographies, and we were doing lots of analysis and stuff, and I recall that we did study about this during our class with James Kondo, Biggie class. I went back and revisited those frameworks like guides and you know, looked into it and felt we need to go much more deeper. So bought new books, asked my team to go for, you know, look into more cases. That's how you keep building on that platform which, you know, we have created at ICS.
Thank you very much, Nitin. And Ace, how about you? Positive impact and negative impacts?
Yeah, I cannot think of any negative impact. Not to be like to be nice to you, but yeah, I cannot think. Yeah, a lot of positive impacts, but let me give you 2 points. One is making decision in really a short time. So you gotta read a lot of cases in a short time, and you know, you have 4 or 5 classes on the same day, you gotta handle it, right? And as you move, you know, higher in your organization, you spend more time making decisions. And that's helping me a lot. And number 2 is, I would say, continuous stimulation from my friends, classmates, professors, from my network. One example is, Toshi is here, he's my classmate. He recently gave me a message on Facebook. He wanted to talk about, you know, how to make, by the way, he's working for one of the major insurance companies, Japanese insurance companies. He wanted to kind of discuss how to digitalize their employees. So we decided to have a lunch meeting. We spent maybe 2 hours, right? Yeah, talking about that. He brought in his kohai, and we had a great discussion. And, you know, this couldn't happen without my MBA classmates. So that's it.
Thank you very much, Ace. The third question we wanted to approach here today is, how did other people perceive your MBA degree and knowledge, perhaps your coworkers? And sorry, I'll start with Ace here.
Okay. I would say just having an MBA doesn't really help with your career now. Maybe it was the case 20 years ago, 30 years ago, but now it's not. But the good thing of having Hitotsubashi MBA is, so being somebody who is interviewing people, I see a lot of resume with the MBA, you know, there. I see a lot of, you know, MBAs from, no offense to KO or Waseda, but, you know, I see a lot of Waseda KO MBAs. Because they have like hundreds of students, but we have only 50 every year. And, you know, we also got the Hitotsubashi brand, right? So, yeah, that stands out, yeah, over other programs.
Thank you very much, Ace. And Nitin, your response, please.
So,
Hitotsu Bashi is a brand to reckon with in Japan, and our professors are well known. It happened with me many times during my interview or in my company. Lots of seniors either have attended a seminar by Kaz Sensei or have read a book by Takeuchi Sensei or Kusunoki Sensei. So as a foreigner who is working in Japan or looking for an opportunity, it's a big credibility, and it gives it really opens up lots of avenue for us. So that was a big positive impact. But however, with a positive impact, it comes with a responsibility. So you have to work on your skills, which is a prerequisite, basically.
Thank you very much. And the last question we have is, what was the biggest takeaway from your MBA experience? I know that did that sound awkwardly familiar, perhaps, but I will start with Nitin.
It's kind of repetitive what I would be saying, but you know, it instilled a habit of engaging with the subject more deeply and more critically. Earlier, the way I was, you know, tackling with the problems at the business was at very superficial level. Now I look at them with a much more analytical mindset, which means my engagement is much more deeper. So that is the biggest takeaway for me.
And Aesong?
Yeah, I agree with your point totally. And if I look at it from a different angle, I'll repeat the same thing. But you know, I'm repeating because it's really important. It's network people. So after 8 years, we are still meeting. 33% came to this event after and we have a lot of people living outside of Japan, as Makoto said. So that's the largest takeaway for me.
Thank you very much for both of you. We have some time way ahead of schedule, and some of the audience was kind enough to give me some questions. And so the ones that I saw that showed up most commonly, and I would like to ask those two, time permitting. So I'll start with Ace on this one. Do you have any career advice for the current students?
So 2 points. One is try to leverage your network. So again, the network, but if you're changing, thinking to change your career, it's always nice to have, reach out to somebody who is already there, right? So that you don't make a mistake and you'll be successful. So that's number one. And number two, this is maybe my personal kind of way of thinking, but if the choice sounds difficult, you better pick that choice, because you will find something new, you learn something new there.
Thank you very much, Ace. And Nitin.
Yeah, I think I completely agree with what Ace is saying. Just to add on it, I think it worked for me. It would be good to think where you want to be in 5 years or 10 years down the line and do the reverse engineering. That in order to go there, what kind of skills you need to acquire today, it will give you some clarity what kind of job you going to do for and what kind of skill set within that job you need to acquire. And that was helpful for me.
Great, thank you very much. And another one that I noticed that popped up quite common was, what kind of skills do you think are good in addition to the MBA degree?
Okay. I've realized in last few years, like I was also involved in digital marketing and data and all that stuff, that data analytical skills is going to be super important. Yes. Oh. I'll get a Starbucks coffee after that. Why I'm saying that, everywhere we go, there's a tsunami of data. It's everywhere. So you need to know, there are, of course, teams and offices in business who are working on those data, but as a manager who is going to work there, you need to have certain kind of skills, how you're going to fetch that data, because we are talking not bits and pieces of data. Just to give you an example, I was leading the digital analytics for ICOS in my previous company, and with current technologies, we have Bluetooth, we have sensors everywhere, and we issued a new device with Bluetooth, and we calculated how much data we'd be gathering. It's billions of rows of data every year. Now the question is how we're going to get the insight out of it. So it's all in raw form. So you need to have, as a manager, the skills of at least some sort of DB, knowledge or SQL. I don't want you to go get into IT, but you need to have those basic, skills. How you're going to gather that data, and then the second one would be, how are you going to visualize it? So you need to have very strong skills of Excel or Tableau, and there are many softwares, but you need to have those as a manager, because you will be dealing with lots of data. And the second one would be, I think, the presentation skills. Once you have all the data with you as a manager, you will be presenting it to someone. You need to sell your ideas. It doesn't necessarily have to be a PowerPoint. It can be a piece of paper. It can be a whiteboard. But you need to have a proper story, simple story behind it. You need to have a logical sequence there. That's very important. And that logical sequence in the story, backed with the solid data, is very effective. So these two skills, I personally felt, it's very important and going to be very important in your future.
Thank you very much. Couldn't help, as I listened to your story, notice the Seki model spinning. It got externalization, combination, very good, knowledge management. And Ace, your response to good additional skills to the MBA.
Data analytics, I totally agree. there will be a lot of skills you definitely need. But, I'm more like a believer of, if you need a skill, you just do it. So let's say if you want to be a director, general manager, you first try to get that position, and you try to experience. Of course, you will fail a lot. You'll be frustrated. Sometimes you might have to leave a job. But that way you will learn more than you can learn from the textbook, of course. So yeah, I would think that way.
Okay, these are the questions I noticed that were more common. Perhaps we can, if there's any questions or from the audience.
Do we have any questions?
Lee, correct?
Sorry, we're going to bring up my.
Thank you very much. I'm Lee from class of 2015. I have a question for Nitin. As a foreigner working in Japan, especially now you're working in management position, so do you have any tips or any comments on how a foreigner can strive to that kind of position, and what kind of challenges you have met, and how you solve all those problems?
I think it might be a little repetitive. Everybody is saying that. Yeah, you have to have Japanese skills, unfortunately, but you need to have Japanese skills. Not because you won't get a job in Japan. Now I'm seeing lots of companies opening up and giving opportunities to foreigners who can't speak Japanese. In my department currently, there's a director who can't speak Japanese. So that's not an issue. The problem is, if you speak Japanese, even if you are showing that you are putting some effort in that direction, you get lots of opportunities within Japan, because ultimately the customers are Japanese, higher management at times are Japanese, so it's going to be very good advantage. Whenever I know you guys don't have, current student might not have time to look in study Japanese, but at least go for certain basic stuff, and because it will show the positivity when you're looking for a job that you're interested in learning that. That's very important. And the second one, which I've said, there's no need to explain where are you from, because Hitotsubashi is a brand. And in my current job, I was talking to my boss recently, and I was saying, oh, I'll be going for Hitotsubashi alumni, and I showed him the pamphlet. And he said, oh, I know Kass-sensei. I have attended his seminar. And he opened his Facebook, oh, Carsensei is my friend. So he used to work in Sharp, and Carsensei has given a seminar there. These kinds of bits and pieces have happened many times with me, where people know about Hitotsubashi. So that brand is there, which will land you a, you know, at least interview job there. And on top of that, if you have a Japanese skill, I think that will do wonders. I hope I've given the answer.
Do we have any other questions from our audience? Oh, there's one in the back.
Hello, my name is Dyson, class of 2017. I have one question for both of you. If you have to explain about ICS to someone who doesn't know about ICS and who is a foreigner, how would you explain the school or program?
Tough question. You know, one thing, going back to my answer to one of the panel questions, is the size. I would say, you know, it's education, right? So better to have a smaller number of students per professor, of course. So I will talk about that.
I think I'll borrow what Ace was mentioning during his answers, that diversity. People have this tendency of looking, oh, if it's a Japanese MBA school, majority of the people or students would be Japanese, and it would be in Japanese. So that's a misconception. So when I tell them, no, it's very diverse, there are people from different countries, and it's all in English, that leaves a very good impression on them. So I always use, oh, diversity is a big, you know, positive for ICS in Japan.
Do you have any other questions from the audience? Class of 2017. I think you've been doing this for the last year. Sorry, I'm not pressuring you. If I may I ask one question? I think you two are on the level of being a manager in your company, and manager has to manage a team, right? And I think one of the experiences we had at ICS is managing a diverse team of diverse nationalities, diverse genders. And do you have any insights into how you can effectively manage a team in your company?
Another difficult one.
Sorry, I know you asked not to ask difficult questions. But
can I? Okay.
Frankly speaking, I'm still struggling with it, you know. Because the kind of companies I've been working, it had lots of diverse players in my team, you know, from many countries. There was Japanese, there were, you know, people from Europe, there were people from Asia, there were people from US. It's a difficult thing, because everybody has a different perspective work. And of course, being in ICS, it helps you to understand and start thinking from their perspective. But when you're, you know, pressed with deadlines and management is pushing you that you have to deliver, you don't want those kind of issues to happen. So frankly speaking, I'm still struggling. In current my team, there is a Mexican guy, and there's a Sweden guy, and then there's a Japanese guy. I'm really impressed with the Japanese guy. You tell them they work hard. Yeah, Swedish and Mexican, they always going in a different directions. So exactly. What I do normally is to sit back, and before giving something to them, I have to think, you know, many times hard. Okay, what kind of questions I'm expecting from them, so that I already have an answer, so that we can save some time and deliver something instead of just fighting within the team. But it's difficult. It's keep on. You have to keep on learning that.
Yeah, I totally agree. And maybe some of I will borrow some of your words. Right, I think diversity, people are different, that these are keywords. I mean, for example, I managed engineers, I managed data scientists, marketers, salespeople. They have a totally different, you know, mindset. And even looking at a specific job, people are different, right? So understanding these is the key. It's really easy to say, but as he was saying, I'm still struggling, learning now.
All right, thank you very much. I think I saw, I see several hands now, okay.
Yeah, hi, Salem from class of 2007, was it? 2007, yeah. So I have a question. What you just answered was about management. So how do you manage a team? And you guys are managers and you have people reporting to you. So I have two questions. One is anyone in your team older? And how do you manage that? Because the younger people in your team will feel entitled. Today's generation is a Google generation. They want everything very quick. They want everything now. The older people in your team are obviously going to feel that should have been me where you're sitting right now. And why should it be you and not me? So how do you mitigate that? And the second piece of it is your answer was about how do you manage, which is very technical and process oriented. My question is, what is your leadership style? So when you go into the office every morning, what kind of a kantoku or captain are you? What kind of a coach are you? How do you lead? What is your philosophy? Not how do you manage? So please kind of don't mix that up, so if you don't mind.
So to answer your first question, what was the question? I had the answer, but it didn't.
Yeah, who's going to win the World Cup?
Okay. That was my question. I got it. So luckily or not, I've been working for a gaishike company, so there's no like a culture of seniority. You know, if you're older, you're more like a erai. I didn't have that culture. And I would say 80% of 90% of people I manage are older. And I didn't really have to really be careful with that, but I tried to be like do a minimum stuff for as a Japanese. I don't, you know, yobisuke, I don't do that for sure. So everybody in the team calls each other using nani-nani-san. So that's one. And talking about my leadership style, I'm still trying to find out what's the best style, but I'm not like a passionate leader, as you can see from how I speak, right? I'm more like a flat person. But I try to make that my advantage rather than my weakness. So, you know, always kind of laissez. So I don't get confused. Try to be, stay calm. So that's my leadership style.
The first question, in current team, there are all junior to me in terms of age and experience. But I did have an experience, what you were saying actually, in last company. There was a Japanese guy who was working for me and he was much older than me. I failed many times, frankly speaking, you know. But I realized one thing, that you have to have a different style with a, you know, different set of, based on the different level of experience your junior has. I did have a freshers from KO and Waseda. You need to literally spoon feed them because they don't know anything. So you need to tell them this needs to happen in this way. This is my way of doing it. And it worked pretty well. But I was doing the same thing and I was trying to, force my thinking on the senior guy. And that actually ruined our relationship. And then I went back to the whiteboard and thought about it and thought, okay, he's much more experienced. He doesn't need to know how. He just need to know what. So I try my best just to tell him, this is the goal and KPI we need to achieve. I'll give you the freedom how you want to, you know, achieve it. So that worked pretty well with the guy who was older than me in terms of experience. That was the first. Second question was, sorry.
The first question was the age.
And the second question?
The World Cup.
Okay, leadership style. I think I'm still developing that. It's very difficult to explain what style you have. It happens it's very difficult to cultivate a new style, I would say. It depends on how, from your background and how you're coming and, you know, what kind of education you had and all those things. But I try one thing every day, which I've learned by burning my fingers, you know. They try to be ahead of them. Whenever I'm giving them task, I know how it needs to be done, at what steps needs to be taken. I have devoted lots of time before giving them a task. That helps me a lot in terms of you know, confidence level and in terms of in-depth thing, because I know where we are going in terms of the task given to me by my boss. So I sit on a white paper and try to jot down, this is how we are going to do it, and this is what we need to achieve. And we fail miserably every time. But at least it gives them a direction, because at times people are looking for directions from you because they think it's not our job, it's your job as a leader to give them directions. So that's the style I use.
So you're saying you take personal time to map out the direction, why it's important to them and what's in it for them? Is that what you're saying?
Yes, so kind of like why it's important is there, but how they're going to achieve it, that also need to be tell them, because you have a limited resources. I can't afford to waste lots of time. We have deadlines to follow. So I give them a room how you approach it's going to be, but I feel these are the directions we should do and break down all the big tasks into the small tasks. This is I've been trying from last 3-4 years, the same thing, that, you know, sit with it, give them why we are doing it. That's very important to know why we are doing what we are doing and how we are going to do it in terms of big task. I hope I was able to answer your question.
Yeah, thank you.
Right, so we have kind of run out of time. I know there's still more questions, but we're going to go into the coffee break now. So if you still have any questions, you can ask them in the coffee break. Please join me in thanking the panelists again. And the coffee break's for 15 minutes, so please come back by 3:18.
18, yes.
My phone is not watching this. one. Right now, only one. That's me.
I am still teaching.
Okay, I will just send some YouTube link. Should I share it on homepage?
あります。クリッカーは、どこだ。
リセッションまで残れる。
longer. I may be here to do a lot. So if you have time, maybe we can pass by and have coffee in Koyama. I know you always have a busy schedule, so I feel bad sending you a I'll give you this one for you. Sensei,
where are you living?
I brought one just for you. When I got this, I told Hanako, this is Takeuchi Sensei right here. I'm just the result. You were the investment that made this happen.
And you are so right. Strategy, leadership, it only matures with time. You never really get it when you're young.
Can I get a picture? I will, but this one is a good one. This is not.
Hiro would take a picture
of the three of us. Yeah. Along with you.
And
the green tie over there. I'm just matching. You know, just matching. I'm looking out temporarily in Aoyama, but they're gonna move me to a place in Hiro. So I'm still doing it. In any case, I'll get close. And Hanako and the kids are coming next month.
Oh, okay.
So they're pretty excited.
Oh,
pretty excited.
Yeah. Yeah. All three of them.
All three. Out of Boston.
How many do
you
have
here? I've been a good boy. We need to coach you on this because you know it's very hard putting the barrier. Because you respect them, but they don't. Boston, huh?
わかんないです。
もう時間だよ。呼んできたらいい。
そうですね。18分とは言ってんですけどね。
18分？
そうそう。3分遅れちゃったから。
じゃあ、18分の前にマイクでアナウンスします。します。
If everybody could take their seats again. So I appreciate if everybody can take their seats again. Okay, we're going to resume. Okay, may I have your attention to the screen, please? Okay, first of all, I want to thank everyone so much for coming back on time after the coffee break, which is like the hardest part of the operations of the Alumni Day. So this year we're bringing in a new feature in the ICS Alumni Day, and we want to award people who made significant contributions to the ICS Alumni Network. I think it's fair to say that without the efforts of the recipients today, I don't think we'll be able to have ICS Alumni Day that's happening now today. So the Alumni Associations made a careful analysis and chose the recipients for the ICS Alumni Association Service Award. And the 2012 to 2016 Alumni Association Board will be the recipients for the Alumni Award. I think in total, six members belong to the 2012 to 2016 Alumni Board. And their names are Ellis Chu, Martha Cho, Matt Wilson, Miku Suzuki, Nick Tanaka, and Alfonso Vega Garcia. Is any one of you currently present? Can you stand up if you're currently here? So ICS Alumni Association doesn't have a lot of money, so we couldn't prepare you a lot of prizes or anything, but we have actually made a certificate of appreciation.
So I would appreciate it if you guys can come up and then receive the certificates. Want to make a comment, or is that too much?
Hi, my name is Ellis from class of 2009. I think the most important thing that gave us the support and the force behind to push us to do something for ICS is because we really enjoyed the time during the 2 years in the school, and we just want to continue to do something more crazy, more drinking party. So we want to use a platform to hold each other, and because of the new digital development, that's fine, and also with this specialist from Google. So we have the website and a lot of things. So I think we just try to do something and make ourselves more happy. And I hope this very pure and very, we do not think too much on any other kind of benefits. We just believe there's a place for the alumni to get together to enjoy their time continuous until one day we can sit back every year to come back in this alumni day. I still remember the first time we were doing the kick, doing with Yoshi Sensei. We're doing that, and we are still only in the student floor, and then now we've seen the development of the ICS alumni day is here, and then we feel very excited, and we didn't really do much, and we are so embarrassed to receive this certificate. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay, I'm actually so delighted to introduce next special speaker, and he served as founding dean of ICS for 12 years, I think. And after that, he came back to the Harvard Business School, and now a professor in the strategy unit at Harvard Business School. And he also a faculty chair for Japan. So even leaving Hitotsubashi University, he still work as a bridge between Japan and other part of the world. And for me personally, he's a teacher of how to dress in classroom. I actually learned a lot from him, but today, looking at his actually the outfit, I actually found that he actually went to the next stage. So I really need to catch up him. Well, actually, I can continue for maybe next 30 minutes to talking about the episode we had together, but maybe I should stop now. And everybody, please welcome Hiro Takeuchi.
Thank you so much. It's a great honor to be back. Sherman, where are you sitting? Right there. Sherman and I were the founding deans and associate deans. The scary factor is Sherman's wife Yoko and my wife Nobuko are sitting there as well. So, I've been asked to say a few words, and I gave the association a choice. I can talk about my research, I can talk about my social activities, I can talk about my sports activities, and so forth, and they wanted me to talk about my research, the most boring topic they chose. So I'm going to spend about 10 minutes of what I'm doing right now, and then the next 10 minutes a little off of research, but my other activities. So I'll split the time half and half. So maybe if you can just turn the lights up front, or is it already? Okay, you can see me, right? Okay. I just submitted a manuscript to the Oxford University Press, a sequel to the book that Jiro Nonaka and I wrote, The Knowledge Creating Company. It's been 25 years since we wrote that book, and we figured we owe the world a sequel. So that's the original book, The Knowledge Creating Company. The subtitle, How Japanese Companies Create the Dynamics of Innovation. So we had case studies of Japanese companies, a lot of them, on how they would create the dynamics of innovation. The next book is titled The Wise Company. So we're moving from knowledge to wisdom. As we age, we get a little wiser, you know. And the subtitle is exactly the same except for one word, continuous. So we're still highlighting Japanese companies. We're still highlighting the dynamics of innovation, but continuous innovation. So the cases are all new. The first case we write about in chapter one is the case on Honda Jet. The first book we wrote about the Honda car case, Tall Boy. But this one, you know, we start off with Honda Jet. And so how can a company that started out selling bicycles, motorcycles into cars go about manufacturing a jet engine aircraft and became the number one selling small jet manufacturer in the United States? So we start off with that case. This is the framework. You've heard of Seki model, right? But in the new book, we use the spiral as the metaphor for how knowledge gets created repeatedly, continuously over time. We use the concept of phronesis as the driver of that. Most of you never heard of phronesis, so I'll define it in a little second. But if you can just do a little exercise for me, pull your chair back a little bit, hands free. Maybe it's easier if you stand up. Let's stand up, yeah. Why don't you all stand up? Maybe the lights go on in the front if somebody's in charge of the lights. Lights will go on in 2 seconds, is it? One, two. No, it doesn't. Okay. can you see me? Okay. So if you can point your, not your middle finger, but your index finger, right around your belly, pointing up towards the ceiling, okay? And I want you to make a circle clockwise. So make sure that the circle you're creating with your finger pointing up is turning clockwise. Okay, bring that up to your chest level, right, with your fingers still pointing up. Shoulder level. Make it a little larger. Your eye level. Above your head. And now look at the circle. It's turning clockwise, right? Okay, have a seat, have a seat, have a seat. Something happened, right? Have a seat, have a seat, have a seat. So if you want to learn, you know, the secret to this, you got to buy the book. So we talk about phronesis, and it is, it's a little too late now. Can you turn it down? thank you. So 2000, it's kind of interesting because people are still going. which is good. 2,400 years ago, Aristotle talked about three virtues. Two of them we use quite a bit in management, in business schools. Epistemology, you've heard of, right? So episteme is science. Techne is technology. But phronesis is the least known of the three virtues Aristotle talked about 2,400 years ago. We define it as the following. So episteme is know why, because we're talking about science. Techne is know how, right, technology. And phronesis is know what should be done. So there's a practice element to it. And we define it as something that enables managers to determine what is good in specific times and situations, to undertake the best actions at those times to serve the common good. Two key words here. One is common good. So we're talking about creating common good, not just for organization, but for society at large. And we're also talking about here and now, at specific time, at specific context. So that's the concept that we use, and that is what is going to be driving Seki. Seki used to be kind of a flat, two-dimensional model. We're trying to make it three-dimensional. We hope we will succeed, and the book will continue to sell. The first book is still selling. So we're gonna retire happily as a result of the first book. This second book will secure a place for us in Hawaii. So we're looking forward to your support. So this is the conceptual part of the book. It is in chapter 3. Chapter 2 is all about philosophy. So we talk about phenomenology, you know, all kinds of things from the philosophy field. And it is also based on an article that Jiro and I wrote a couple of years ago for the Harvard Business Review called The Wise Leader. And we're defining wise company as companies that have wise leaders. Simple as that. And we identified six qualities of a wise leader. A wise leader has these abilities: ability to judge goodness, ability to grasp the essence, the ability to create ba, you've heard of ba, right? The ability to communicate the essence. It's not enough just to grasp the essence, you have to be able to communicate it. The fifth is ability to exercise political power. The word political throws people off. So these days we're using being Machiavellian as a replacement for political power. And the sixth is foster practical wisdom and others. So let me just go through each one of them. And what I'd like you to do and I'm going to do a survey a little on later on, is of these six qualities, which one do I excel? So I'm going to go through these six qualities and, yeah, just subjectively ask yourself, you know, do I put a circle yes on all six of these qualities, or are there two or three that you excel? So I'm going to have a little dialogue with you on that. So the first one is judging goodness. The key word here is what is good for the organization and society. In Japanese, we say, yonotame, shito no tame, right? So this is not just good for you, your organization, but for society. And in order to be able to judge that, you need a pretty deep understanding of liberal arts. And, you know, we kind of talk about him because he's Peter Drucker, who said, management is a liberal art. Very popular in Japan, not as popular in the United States. Clayton Christensen, Michael Porter, you know, they are better known in the management field. In Japan, you talk about management, people talk about him, right? How many of you read Moshidora? Right? There's even a book that sold 3.5 million copies in Japan. Moshimo, if the manager, who happens to be a woman, of a high school baseball team read Peter Drucker's Management. That's the title of the book. So we kind of make it short, Moshidora, right, is sold 3.5 million copies. Amazing. It's a pretty serious book. The cover is manga, so half the people bought it thinking it was manga, but in reality, it's pretty serious. Every situation, context, they say, well, you know, how would Peter Drucker respond, or what's written up in Peter Drucker's Management for this? So it's context specific. So it's very much, you know, what do you do in a specific situation? Goodness probably comes from really understanding liberal arts. Now, in Japan, unfortunately, except for a few universities, liberal arts not a very serious topic. In the United States, most of the good universities, the big ones and small ones, right? Harvard, Yale, Princeton, name it, the big ones. Small ones, Carleton, Smith, Swarthmore, Wesleyan, they all teach 4 years of liberal arts. That's what, you know, that's the foundation. And then you go specialize in a specific field for business, law, medical school. You go to professional schools, which is graduate level, right? Or you go to computer science, you go to, that's graduate level. But the first 4 years, basically, you're building the foundation with liberal arts. So that enables you to be able to judge what's good, not only for the organization, but for society. So we kind of stress the importance of common good as the first quality. The second quality is grasping the essence. And the key word here is intuitively. So how do you grasp the essence of something? And the best photo we can find is of this man, Soichiro Honda. You've seen this photo probably. Jiro Nonaka uses this all the time. He no longer teaches in the MBA program, I'm told. So maybe the newer students have not had the pleasure of being taught by Jiro Nonaka. The older folks, and I see some older folks here, they certainly have. You remember the 40-page project that he had to write, right? This is his favorite photo. There's Soichiro Honda, the founder of Honda company on the left, squatting, telling the test driver of this motorcycle, this is a test vehicle, to go around 30 times around me as close as possible, right? And after 30 rounds, he will tell the people who are standing in the back, these are the developers of this test motorcycle, go ahead or do it over again. Whenever Soichiro said, do it over again, 99.9% of the time, there's something wrong with the test motorcycle. So this is like the 28th time the test driver is circling around Soichiro Honda. The guys in the back are looking, you know, quite concerned. Is he going to say, all right, or is he going to say, do it over again? But how can he tell? Elementary school education, but he probably gets it intuitively, right? Steve Jobs, the same thing. His greatest strength was being able to grasp the essence intuitively. So this is the second quality. The third quality is creating ba. And the key word here is constructing new meaning through interactions. Jiro Nonaka, you know, has a pretty good sense of humor. When I invited him to the Harvard Business School, he purposely mispronounced the word ba, and he called it bar. And he says, the best way to understand ba is the pub in the UK. You go into a pub, open, anybody can come in, you kind of exchange ideas, there are interactions, right? Right now, if you go to a pub in the UK, they'll all be talking about the World Cup, probably, right? A lot of exchanges, you know, how stupid is this and that, you know, and so forth, right? But maybe through that interaction, new meaning may come out. So it is a context. The timing is important, right? Creating the ability to create a ba is a quality of a wise leader. It's not joining a ba, but creating one. So one of the best examples we found is this man. Inamori-san became the chairman of Japan Airlines, JAL, when he was 78 years old. The company went bankrupt. They asked him, the founder of which company? Kyocera and KDDI, right? To come and resurrect JAL. And the first thing he did was the famous Kompa. So in the executive, the room they had these executive meetings, he would ask people at 8 o'clock in the evening, 100 yen per person, with beer and surume, that smelly little cuttlefish, right? And with drinks. You will talk your gut feel, you'll talk about the honne, and the executives first rejected, how can you drink beer and the smelly thing, you know, surume, in our executive, room? But gradually, you know, this thing spread in the organization. And so he was able to get to the guts of the issue through interactions, through kompa. So this is a good example of him creating a ba at JAL. And the fourth is communicating the essence. The key word here, metaphors, stories. So you've been taught by Ken Kusunoki, storytelling as essence of strategy, stokyo. It doesn't resonate with you guys. Are you guys dajobu? So he took over the strategy course, right, Ken Kusunoki. So the famous book for him is Story toshite no Kyousou Senryaku, and we shorten it to Stokyo. His whole line is the importance of storytelling. So metaphor is very important, storytelling very important. The best example I can give you is this man in the middle. You know who he is, right? Picotaro. We happened to meet him on November 6th of last year when President Trump came and Prime Minister Abe had a party for him. And he was the star of the evening. Not President Trump, but more people came to his table than to President Trump's table. He was able to communicate. He is now the ambassador of Japan for SDG. He's like the ambassador of Japan to foreign countries, right? The ability for him to communicate the essence is phenomenal. You know, I mean, it's a simple thing like this is a pen, this is an apple, pineapple, right? Kind of thing, right? It's so simple, but he just conveys the essence so particularly well. You know the guy on the right, right? Nobel laureate, Yamanaka Shinya, IPS guy. And he goes over to Picotaro, and they're talking like friends. So Picotaro happened to be in the same table as me. There were three boring Gaimusho people and three boring, Washington, D.C. Bureaucrats in my table. And there was Picotaro at the very end. Yamanaka sensei would come over and they're chatting away, joking and so forth. So I said, Shinya, introduce me to Picotaro. I don't know him. You seem to be good friends. He said, no, I met him just for the first time today. I said, but you're talking as though you're old friends. He says, a month ago, won first spot in a Halloween party, dressed like him. So when you look at him, he put on a little mustache. So Yamanaka sensei won the Halloween party dressed like him. I just picked this as a great example of a great communicator. I promised him that I will invite him to Harvard in the next 2 or 3 years. So he's with AVEX. The two young managers of the company came to me immediately exchanging name cards. And I've been getting mails and when is the invitation coming? kind of thing. So it'll happen pretty soon. The fifth one, the key word here is bringing people with conflicting goals and spurring them to action. So we use the word political power, but I think we should have probably used the word Machiavellian, being shrewd, not so much the ends kind of meet the means kind of thing, but being astutely shrewd in making judgment calls. Basically feel that the world is full of contradictions, opposites, and paradox. So you have to kind of deal with reality and be able to make political judgments here and there. So that's the fifth quality. One of your faculty members, Emi Osono, see her in the top left, right? And a former colleague of ours, Nori Shimizu. The old folks all have been taught by Nori, ex-BCG vice president, right? The new guys probably have not seen him. But when we did a survey 5 years ago, who was the professor who had the biggest impact on your life after graduating from ICU, he was ranked number one. So yeah, he's a very prominent ex-faculty. So we wrote this book, and our book was all about radical contradictions. So how does Toyota deal with contradictions? COP, as we said, right? Contradictions, opposites, and paradox. And they kind of make it a way of life. That, you know, COP is the natural state. Not having COP is there's something wrong with your, with a company if you don't have contradictions. So we wrote the book on that. We also introduced the dialectic thinking. The case method is nothing else but dialectic thinking, right? So the case instructor, Yoshi, says, what do you think? What's your action plan? And, you know, you say something, right, the thesis, and then hopefully somebody says, I disagree, right? And we'll present the antithesis. That starts a lively discussion, right? And after 80 minutes, back and forth, maybe you arrive at a synthesis. You not something in between, which is a compromise, but a notch higher level, right? So this is dialectic thinking. And the case method is basically a tool for getting to a higher level of understanding. So over time, this becomes a thesis, right? Erase the sin. And over time, somebody has to continuously come up with, I disagree. Lively interaction. And you know, this is how you go up the level on dialectic thinking. So that's the fifth. And the last one is fostering practical wisdom for nieces in the organizations, cascading it down the organization. And here, the key word is apprenticeship. I think the recent word for that is mentoring, but it's good old apprenticeship. So you work with the old master. It comes from, you know, from Europe originally, but we have this photo as an example. This is Yanai-san, Tadashi Yanai of Uniqlo, of fast retailing. He meets with his store staff people twice a year, every time 4,400 people from around the world, 4,400, right? And here he is talking, he always addresses them for the first hour. It's a day and a half meeting on what he believes in, where the company should be going, right? So he spends the time and money, you know, bringing 4,400 people twice a year to Yokohama is an expensive proposition. But this is how apprenticeship is conducted. And he does it very successfully. So these are the six qualities. And let me just go back to those six qualities and yeah, just self-assess among yourselves. You know, of the six, which one do I really excel in? Which one do I need improvement on? And if I had the time, I would do a live discussion, but I'm only allotted 25 minutes, so I'm going to go on. But that's the kind of discussion we can have. I also ask people to executive in the executive program to circle each one, and certain people will circle all six, Others will say no to all six, and it's a great live data. And I say, if you were the head of human resource for Google, which one would you hire? Someone that said yes to all six, or someone that said no to all six? Very lively discussion. There's usually two camps. And so, again, that's a dialectic method, right? And it invites a lot of ideas and discussion, and that's why the case method is so effective. So I'm going to skip that process today. If I'm called back to teach at ICS again, you know, I'll try to do something like that. But let me talk about mission, vision, and values, because this is straight out of our framework. Because strategy taught at the Harvard Business School is outside in. You analyze the environment, you analyze the industry, remember five forces, you analyze the competitor, the value chain, right? And you decide on your strategic positioning based on that analysis. So it's outside in. A lot of the things that we talk about in the new book, The Wise Company, it's inside out. You start with your belief. You start with purpose. And then you kind of branch out in deciding your strategic positioning based on subjective intuition, could be. So that's the approach. And MVV is very much along those lines. Mission is, you know, why do we exist? Same for humans, same for organizations. Why do organizations exist? Now, at the Harvard Business School, there's a very clear-cut answer, right? And in the finance course at ICS, there's a very clear-cut answer, right? Ask Max. Maximize shareholder value. That's why we exist, right? And we say, yep, that's true. But are there other reasons why you exist? So we start out with this kind of a question. One of my students made it to the cover of Fast Company, which is a monthly magazine, very popular in Silicon Valley. And the title of which was Find Your Mission. It's a 22-page article based on the inside-out approach to business strategy. This was very comforting for me because it says, Takeuchi is not the boldest-faced name at Harvard yet. So there's still a chance for me to be as bold-faced as Michael Porter or Clayton Christensen, right? It's going to take some time. But they are talking about the inside-out approach. And vision is, what kind of a future do you want to create? It's not about what kind, you know, of a company do you want to become 10 years from now. It's about creating the future. And so in our book, we feature Honda Jet. Because from day one, this man, his vision was human mobility into the skies. That was his vision. He wanted to fly. He was a licensed pilot. He was told by the company not to fly again because he crashed at Hamamatsu Airport when he was landing. His wife was a pilot as well. And so, you know, even when he was manufacturing motorcycles, that was his dream. So he called the first motorcycle Honda Dream. The logo he created, which is now on all motorcycles, is this one. So he had the wing in mind. So no wonder, you know, he was very successful in creating this. This is like 20 years after he passed away, but there was a DNA within the company. Fujino, a young engineer, took on the job. Only four people in the company, this was a secret project, knew about this. And you know, this is the best-selling small jet in America. Somebody called it the fusion of Civic with NSX. Civic is the fuel-efficient car, right? NSX is the sexy sports car that Honda came out with. And yeah, this is the end product. Values, MVV, the last one is, what values or beliefs do you hold dear? And this also, you know, applies both to humans as well as organizations, right? What values do you hold dear? And in 2001, Toyota came up with the Toyota Way. This is like 70 years after the company was started. So when you open this book of 8 pages, it has quotes, historic words of Sakichi Toyota, historic words of Kiichiro Toyota, historic words of Taichi Ono. Ask why 5 times. Now, so these are all quotes from previous executives as well as current executives. So these are the beliefs of the company. They published this in English because they want to become global. It's also in Japanese. So this is known as the Green Book in the company. I'll skip that. I do have my 30 commandments that I give to my undergraduate. Right before I came here, this is my reunion day. I had my reunion with my Zemi students, undergrads, in Omotesando until 2:30. And I'm now here with my graduate students. So this is what I would pass to my students 3 days before they graduated. At our house, they assemble at dinner time, and I go through all 30 of them, and you know, I spend about 30 minutes per commandment. And so by the time we get to number 30, it's like 5 o'clock in the morning. But this is right before graduation day, and I pound these ideas into their heads. This is the belief, guys. So all my Zemi students have this Meishi-sized Hero 30 Commandments. These are the beliefs. They believe in it. And today in our reunion, they were quoting number 24, you know, isn't that? So that's that. So I'm going to talk about my non-research activities. What do I do? Spend my time. In the Zemi this afternoon for my undergraduates, I had 16 of them, but I've curtailed it to 10. Because about 6 of them are proprietary. They are personal. If it gets known to the public, I get in trouble. But I can share everything with my Zemi students. But here, I don't know who's assembled. But I know 254 of my students from my Zemi. And Yoshi is one of my Zemi students. Toshi is one of my Zemi students, and so is Emi Osono. But anyway, I've curtailed it to 10. And here's how I spent my life. So I've been doing a lot of work in the Tohoku area after 3/11 in 2011. I have taken HBS students 8 years in a row. Last year, 44 of them went. They spent $3,500 plus airfare to spend 9 days in Japan, half of which they spend volunteering, doing volunteer work in Tohoku, as well as consulting with entrepreneurs in Tohoku in helping out their business. So the book came out last year in Japanese. Why does Harvard go to Tohoku kind of thing. It was written by Yamazaki Mayuka, who is a staff member of the HBS Japan Research Center. And it's here if you want to see it later. But it, after 5 years, she wrote what the HBS students have done in Tohoku. And yeah, this is our eighth year, and they really appreciate our coming back. They say, you know, Japanese university students, yeah, came 2 years, but just stopped coming after the third. But you guys are coming every year for 8 years in a row. And I'm hoping we'll be able to do it 10 years, and then I'm going to retire. But this is the book we did. So the first year we went, this is 3 hours of work, of volunteer work, picking debris from, this is Onagawa. I am wearing that red hat. But, you know, 3 hours, you know, collect this much debris there. This is Fukushima High School. We make sure that we go visit the high school students to give them energy. But in fact, our students get a lot of energy. These students, when we spend a day with them, they will tell our MBA students, Mike, I go to Harvard. So they get motivated with our students. So this is one of the photos. The second thing I work on is a thing called HLAB. It stands for, originally stood for Harvard Liberal Arts Beyond Borders. So originally it was a bunch of Harvard undergraduates who came to Japan, spent 9 days with high school students from Japan, teaching them the basics of liberal arts. So if somebody was a philosophy major, he or she will teach philosophy. If somebody was a stat major, you know, he or she would teach that. So this is a camp that they created. And it was this guy who started HLAB. He is a former student at Hitotsubashi undergrad, who sent in an application to Harvard simultaneously. So he got an acceptance on May 1 from Harvard. So he comes to me and says, what should I do? I said, of course, go to Harvard, right? But he goes to Harvard in September and says, wow, there's 1,600 new students, and there's only one Japanese, me. Next year, out of the 1,600 new entrants to Harvard College, right, undergrad, this is where, you know, you did the undergrad, right? Right, yeah. 1,600, Oka Yohei was the only Japanese. So there's 2 years in a row, one out of 1,600. And there were a lot of, you know, students from India, from China, from Korea, but only one. So they started this program, said, we got to do something about this. So maybe we'll send our college students over, you know, tell them how exciting liberal arts is, and they may change their mind. Rather than applying to Todai, we'll apply to Harvard, to Princeton, whatever, right? So this has been going on for 7 years. It's been a very successful program. So we're kind of grateful to him. He, when he was graduating Harvard College, got an offer from a lot of good places, including BCG, turned it down, and is now in charge of HLAB in Japan. It's a nonprofit. Well, let me tell you, it's probably making 1/5 of what he could be making at BCG. But, you know, very worthwhile. So that's number three. Number three is ISAC. How many of you have heard of International School of Asia in Karuizawa? Okay, some of you have. Okay, so this is I think full-time program in Karuizawa, taught entirely in English, and it's a boarding situation. And it was started, summer school started 8 years ago. The program started 4 years ago. Last year they had the first class graduate, 51 of them graduated. Only 15% are Japanese. The person who did the startup was this woman, Lynn Kobayashi. She's the one who organized everything, you know, got the approval of Nagano Prefecture to start ISAC. You can get an international baccalaureate as well as the Japanese certificate if you graduate from ISAC. And she's been a phenomenal entrepreneur in the education business. She collected nanaoku yen, 7 million US dollars, by asking donations from 100 founders to contribute 1,000,000 yen per person. And that's how she got the funding. So rather than just knock on the door of Ministry of Education, she basically said, you know, we can do this on the basis of donation. And I happen to be the lucky one to be the first one of the first 100. So I've been supporting her for the last 6-7 years. The fourth one is this thing called Yanai Scholarship. Yanai is the CEO of Fast Retailing. So this is the first recipient of the Yanai Scholarship, 37 of them. Each got $70,000 per year times four, $280,000, to attend an American university. So H-Lab is involved in this as well, but this is the first year. Second year, 29 students got accepted. So this is no strings attached. Instead of going to Todai, you know, if you're accepted at any of the schools and colleges in the United States, I'll support you. $280,000. You lived a little too early. So, yeah, if you were 16, 17, you would qualify for the scholarship. These 37 lucky people got that scholarship. Phenomenal, right? So I'm one of the two judges, Yanai-san being the other. So if you have friends, you know, who are going to be applying, I take bribes, by the way. The thicker, the better. Let me know, and you know, I can work favors for you. The fifth thing I work on is an executive education program called Knowledge Forum. Jiro Nonaka is the head of this program. We have 300 some people who graduated from this program. Yours truly is here. Kaz has taken over the program after I left for Harvard. This was the 10th reunion, was it? Right? So we published a book June 22nd, so a couple of days ago, where the participants wrote articles, and Jiro pulled it together. He wrote the foreword, I wrote the epilogue, and it's in Japanese, but it's all about, it says liberal arts to leadership, the concept thing. So if you're interested, this is the one that just got published. We're very proud of this achievement. So we have had 30 Japanese companies send their executive to this program. The first batch that graduated, there are 7 CEOs from those companies, including Mitsui and some of the best Japanese companies. And all of them have made it to executive suite. So this has been a very powerful program. And the title of the epilogue is, Why Did We Accept Jiro's Wagamama? His selfish request. In the foreword, he talks about my selfish request to the dean of ICS, and that was me at that time. He came to me and says, Hiro, I don't want to teach MBAs anymore. I said, why? He says, by the time those guys get into important positions, I'll be dead. So he says, I want to make an impact, while they're alive. So I said, oh, okay, and I created this thing. So he's very happy with this program. And, he's seen a lot of these guys make it to the top. Kaz has taken over this very successful program called Knowledge Forum. The sixth one is something I started last year called the Global Academy. And we are going to create credentials, third-rate global manager, second level, first level, we're calling it the Global Academy. The first batch were these people. These are the founders of Agos and of Cerego, Eric Young and his brother Kenneth. And what we're trying to do is emulate the Japan Ski Association. How many of you have Sankyu from Japan Ski Association? Nikyu? Ikyu? Okay. Whoever gets into Sankyu for the Japan Ski Association always makes it to Ikyu. From third level to first level. So you gotta pass these tests, right? And you gotta show it on the slopes. And there are clear-cut criteria on what qualifies as third level, what qualifies as second level, and what qualifies as first level. The Japanese are so diligent that everybody can make it to the third level. If you give them the third level qualification, they all end up going to EQ, first level, right? So we said, this is the way to do it. How can the Japanese be third from the bottom in TOEFL scores in Asia? We're not dumb, right? We're diligent, but we're third from the bottom just above North Korea? How can that be, right? Because we don't have the right system. So we said, well, we'll create the Japan Ski Association ladder, bring them in at the third level, presentation skills, critical thinking, and so forth, and then we'll have 4 different criteria, and we'll push them up to the first level. If we do that, the mission of Global Academy is enabling Japan to compete again. So this is at the people level. And so we started this program. This is the second year we're doing it. And so far, so good. We'll have an app, a very interactive app that will allow people, in a very fun way, to learn to pronounce English properly, to use movie English using AI. You guys were taught about AI this morning, right? This afternoon. So anything that goes on into YouTube is public property. So we can use any. So if you want to know the word damn, right? There'll be like 8 different versions of the actual actor and actress, on video with the quote on damn. And if you say, I want Humphrey Bogart, Casablanca, you push that, Humphrey Bogart comes out and says, I don't give a damn. So you can repeat that as many times as you want, right? And by, you know, the third day, you're going to be able to say, I don't give a damn, right? So this is now available through AI. So we're going to make learning English easy, fun. Same thing with presentation skills. So this is what we're going to do. Wish us luck. Women leaders. So we started this 2 years ago. This is a program we started with Nomura Management School. This is this year's batch. I am here. Joe Badaracco, my colleague at HBS, is here. And David Moss is here. We have been asked by the Prime Minister to start this program, HBS has, and we agreed. This is the second time we're doing it. So 60 companies are sending their women executives to this program. And it is a ball. It is so much fun teaching this group. If they are a minority in a men's society, they act very differently. If they are the majority, they are so aggressive. Hands go up like you wouldn't believe, right? And they talk and talk and continue to talk. The telling story is when every year the Prime Minister comes, cheers them up, right, on a Friday. And when Prime Minister stands on the podium right there, right, and he starts speaking, the women rush to the front, right? And what do they do? Pull out their iPhone and start taking photos right in front. The men never do that. They're too embarrassed to do that, but the women, you know. So I think women are going to change Japan. I am convinced. But we have to put them not as a minority, but let them become the majority. Then Japan will change. So I am convinced. So we're going to be doing the third round next year with the same teaching group. So we do a thing called the Zemi Gashka. I have 16 years of Zemi. Do you still have Zemi at ICS? Okay, so you belong to a certain faculty member, right? So each year, you know, we do a Zemi 20 years after graduation. We all assemble in Maui and spend 3 days talking about the past, the present, and 20 years from now. What are we going to do? So this was last year, 18 showed up. This was the largest group for the undergrad Zemi. And I'm sitting in the middle. So there are now speculation because I have now done 14 years and I have two more Zemi to go because I have gone up to 16 Zemi. So there's now talk about if I finish the undergrad, do I come to ICS or do I repeat the undergrad starting from round one? You let me know. Always negotiable. But anyway, I do that. The article that I'm writing now is called The Fusion of Analog and Digital. In this day and age of high velocity change, I contend there is a place for humans, there's a place for digital, for AI. In the 0 to 1, where you need imagination, humans still are going to be a lot more effective. But from 1 to 9, leave it up to big data, leave it up to AI, leave it up to IoT, leave it up to, what's AR? Okay, you guys are up to speed on this. Good, good. So they're going to be better than humans on this. So AlphaGo is going to beat the Go master, right? But 9 to 10 is where sensitivity is important. So when it comes to innovation, humans still excel here. So that's going to be the next article. I'm writing that right now. And the last one I want to talk to you about is Tokyo Olympics. So back in 1964, I was 17 years old. I cheated my age. I was supposed to be 18, but I did become the official interpreter for the Tokyo Olympics back in 1964, right? So for year 2020, I am going to volunteer to become the first Japanese to be the official interpreter for two Olympics. So I am going to quit Harvard to become the interpreter for the 2020 Tokyo Olympics. The difference is, back then, we were paid. It was arubaito. But this year, they're going to start the application in September. It's all on volunteer basis, pro bono. But I don't, I talked to Muto-san, who is in charge of the Olympics Japanese organization. I happened to run into him yesterday. I said, that's going to be my dream. And he immediately said, you're hired. So in 2020, that's what I'm going to be doing. So look for me in this kind of a uniform. I'll look a little younger than this, but I'm going to enjoy my official interpreter job in 2 years from now. Thank you very much.
All right, thank you so much, Hiro-sensei. We were supposed to finish the program at 4. And the reception was supposed to start at 4:30.
Okay.
But it's okay. It's okay. So that's all the program we have for today. Thank you so much for coming. I want to thank the school, Shingo, Sen, and all the staff members from ICS for making this possible. I want to thank Ken and Deepak and all the others who've supported to make this day possible. And off you go to 10th floor. The reception is on 10th floor, so off you go. Yes, there's going to be a reception afterwards. And one thing I want to mention is that there's going to be umbrellas that you brought outside. So when you go to the 10th floor,